नमस्ते।
So, like with everyone else, I would request you to start by sharing your earliest memories of the concept or the practice of Ahimsa.
I'm remembering my great grandmother. My earliest recollections actually are of a cow shed that we used to have in our home. Right in the back, it was an old large home, it was a joint family home. So, there was a cow shed. And we had a cow called Lakshmi, right? And I think the earliest memories of kindness and so on are from watching my grandmother, the way she would deal with that, with the cows, and especially with Lakshmi, which was her favorite. Yeah, there was a certain very gentle caring. Yeah, the other very interesting thing was we used to have this habit. Before food was served, the youngest kid in the family had to run outside and see if there are any guests at the tinne. So you have to offer them first in case there was anybody there before we started eating. I was a child just born just after the independence. Na? So there was a great spirit at that time of nation building and how one should take it seriously, that India is something worth investing in, that India has a lot of problems, right? There was no running away from the problems of India, but these problems have to be looked at from a point of compassion, and one has to really understand what it means to rebuild the country. After I finished my BTech in IIT, na? There were only 3-4 of us who did not apply to go abroad.
Raghu, you have worked at the intersection of the traditional science and technology realm and in the conventional corporate world. You have straddled both worlds in, I would say easily the last 40 years. Yeah. In what ways did Ahimsa feature either as a reality or as an impossibility?
Both.
Both.
I think the reason why I've been straddling studying Indian technology and looking at applications is primarily because of my interaction with Dharampalji. Just after I left college, na? Just around that time, the final year and around that time, there was a lot of discussion actually among students about what it means, because the Naxalite movement was starting at that time. It was a very interesting phase. Actually, there's a very close friend of mine who went away to Telangana. He dropped school, college when he was in the third year. And all that. So there was a big shakeup. And also that was the time when all over the world there was a questioning, na? The Vietnam War and all of that. So there was a ferment, if you want to call it, at that point of time. Yeah. And all of us were excited, at least some of us who were very serious about these questions, were very excited when Dharampalji came to India, to Chennai, right? And started interacting with many of us. Right, and there was also another professor, Professor Seshadri. Dharampalji was a Gandhian, right? He had studied the entire question of what was India at the time when the British came in. He had gone to London, he had stayed there for many years and spent a lot of his energy, his time and his money just studying this question, what was India in the 1750s? And his insight into Indian history, his insight into how to look at things from an Indian perspective was phenomenally impressive.
I'm curious how, in his understanding of the pre-British past, Dharampal understood the place of non-violence in Indian society.
Yeah, I have to keep saying Sashi and I because, yeah, we got married also, I guess, because of this, whatever. So, in any case, yeah. Now, one of the questions that Dharampalji would ask is, how do you understand India? And his interpretation was that using a colonized mind, to interpret India was a form of Himsa. So when you spoke either to Dr. Seshadri or to Dharampalji, they would point out where our dialogue and discourse was a colonized discourse. Right? And decolonizing itself, I think for both of them, was a very important aspect of Ahimsa. Because it's a very oppressive thing to take on another view and say that every indigenous view of mine is somehow subordinate, right? Or it has to be held in shame. Yeah. So what happened was that the other challenge that Dharampalji placed on us was, can you go and study something Indian in depth? And he said, spend at least 10 years, go find a good teacher and study at least for 10 years. And then don't just glorify the Indian learning, see how it can be applied. And if you can't apply it, there's no point glorifying it. When I started working, for example, with craft people, yeah, so I've been involved quite a bit with working with reviving crafts and things like that. And again, it was very fortunate for me when I was doing work in these developmental areas that one could have dialogues with Dr. Seshadri and with Dharampalji. The way they would help you to interpret events and the way they looked at an internalizing of the colonized idea, internalizing of a Western idea, and just superimposing it in a sense without respecting the local is a very deep form of Ahimsa. And then when one studied a little more about Indian justice systems and all that, yeah, one would learn that, you know, reclaiming balance was more important than punishment.
Raghu, right? In this, I understand about the balance, and yet, how do we then contend with the contemporary strivings for dignity? Could you share how you process the contemporary 21st century challenge or dilemmas of balance in the positive sense that you have just described it, and the need for dignity for all that the contemporary system or the contemporary democratic ethos requires?
Let me just give you one small, you know, actual example of what happened. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sometime in the late 90s, there was a request made to me, Suresh, and Pradeep, yeah, to look at work with the social welfare department in Tamil Nadu. Okay, so here is a system which is highly structured, and it has got the evils, in a sense, if you want to call it, both of the hierarchical Western system. Governments are so hierarchical and role bound, right? Because you've internalized a colonial system without ever questioning it. So all those structures and those kinds of oppressive ways of holding roles are there. Plus you have what is called caste issues. And the social welfare department is working in villages where they have to contend with differences. So how do you work with this, right? So what we did was, we said, let us experiment with the older system that we had seen working in the panchayati context, which is what we call the kudam.
Okay, that's a traditional term. That's
a traditional term in South India. Then we found that it's there all over India. The word kudam simply means coming together. Okay, and in traditional homes all over, you have a central open space which is called the kudam. It's an architectural thing also. And in towns you have, in old towns, you'll have a space where all the people from the village can come together, which is also called a kudam space. Now what happened here is very, very interesting. What happens here is people drop all the differences in role and other terms, right? And come together as human beings who are interested and concerned about a dharmic issue. When we shared this experience with an engineering college group of students, what happened was that there was a peon, the college peon, standing there, and he was seeing us talking about this whole thing to this group college students. After we finished, he's saying in Tamil again, it's beautiful. Sir, enna padippu padikiranga sir ivanga dharmangra vaathai kuda neenga evlo explain pandringa. They said that, you know, what is it? These are supposed to be educated people, and you're sitting here explaining to them what the word dharma means. And this is so beautiful, Rajni, because these people understand the word dharma, right? And what they understand as dharma is also layered and very nuanced understanding of the word dharma. Yeah. So, for example, when we work with water, it's very, very clear. The moment you say that water is a dharmic question, they all understand what it means. Right? That it is something that's going to help me, it's going to help you, it's going to help the whole village, and it's going to help the life forms around us. Therefore, it's a dharmic question. Now, we have to explain this to people, you know, largely English speaking Indians. We have to explain dharma. But the village people would understand the difference between, this is a dharmic question for the whole village. How the kudam works is this. When you come into the kudam, you drop all attributions to yourself, which are based on position, power, property, all of that. You come in as human beings. You engage with a question that is of equal importance to everybody. And every person in the kudam has equal voice. So there is a very, very solid understanding of democracy, where in the kudam, everybody has equal voice because it impacts everybody's life. And in the operational side, you have differences. So people know how to respect both. And decisions made in the kudam, which have a higher dharmic force, let us say, will precede their other ideas of self and differences. So people from apparently different caste groups would come together and work together beautifully on these kind of issues. So it's an old tradition where you have both. You have an understanding of larger and larger dharma, right? Larger and larger circles of belonging and your own self. This understanding of this kind of a dharmic sense, he equated with Gandhiji's idea of the oceanic circles, right? Where when I act in dharma, right, and I understand greater and greater circles of inclusiveness, and I bring in the concept of dharma into greater and greater circles of inclusiveness, then my actions will be ahimsa, ahimsatmik. This is the connection between the political process and ahimsa. The question, what is dharma, is simply to ask yourself, right? What will give me life? What action will increase or enhance my life, your life, if I'm dealing with you, and the life of the context simultaneously?
This idea of multi-layered inclusiveness from that, when you look at the reality of India from that frame, and you're saying that that was fundamentally an ahimsa, a non-violent frame, then how do you understand the reality of caste hierarchy, and how Because the modern view is that caste is fundamentally violent and there's no other dimension to it. So can you respond to
this? I differ from this fully. The Western descriptions of stratification and all of that, we have to keep aside completely. Yeah. Therefore, using the word caste itself is not right. Right? Yeah. And I'm also coming from studying the Vishwakarma as a community and so on. I've also studied the weaver communities. Right? Now, there's a question, there's an idea of jati. There's an idea of socio-economic, technical ecosystems. So if you look at the Vishwakarma, for example, it's a large community which has woodworkers, metal workers, stone workers, and so on. They intermarry and all of that. But the tricks of the trade, in a sense, yeah, of the metal worker stays with the metal worker family. Right? And they form a separate sub-guild, in a sense. Yeah, so if you go to a place like Tirupur, na, and see how business happens there, it has echoes of these kind of patterns, where there are large, in a sense, ecosystems that get formed. There are subsystems within that which have got specializations, and they're very flexibility, with great flexibility, they form and reform. So it's almost like you have, you know, great specialized capabilities in various small groups. And these small groups come together every time there is a demand from the outside. So a whole system gets formed spontaneously with tremendous speed. You can rely on everybody's sense of quality because it is their dharma to do something of a certain quality. Right? So I don't know how you can call them castes. These were guilds.
Yes.
And
yes.
I have a feeling, this is again my interpretation based on all these dialogues, that what you're seeing today is an impoverished India. So according to Dharampalji's work, these kinds of guilds and the, while the guilds were quite clear, I don't think the differentiation, the oppression and so on was very high in the 1750s and on. It's become progressively more and more and more oppressive as we have got impoverished. I also see a parallel between the internalization of a Western hierarchy where the more educated Indians started identifying themselves with the oppressor more and more. Yeah, there's a whole complex historical set of things that have happened, na? Where these earlier stratifications, which first, because we were rich, were not very oppressive. And second, because there were so many other practices within the older system, also were not very oppressive. Became progressively more and more clannish, more and more oppressive, till it's become what we see today. So what we see today is reprehensible. There's no two ways about it.
What would today be an ahimsak approach to the reality of honor killings, which we see happening across India in the name of caste identity or religious identity? How should we tackle it?
I don't think what is happening today can really be handled in a very progressive way, either way. See, if you use Western morality, you send this guy to prison and punish him. Right? And has that changed the social context? Right? Now, the Kap Panchayats, the way they work today, have become extremely defensive. So what they are trying to do is not to re-establish balance. They're not trying to re-establish anything like dharma. So if we have to correct this and go back to ahimsa, the way I'm assuming it used to be, or, you know, let's say that's an ideal understanding of what there was, one has to go back to several other ways of looking at oneself. Yeah, let me explain this. See, I've also worked with the Dalit groups, na? Right? And I've worked with, you know, fairly intense, week-long self-reflective processes with them. Now, I'm a Brahmin. So when I go in, I tell them I'm a Brahmin. This is who I am. This is what I am, whatever, whatever. And there are two kinds of reactions. Okay, there'll be one set of people who will say, why the hell are you coming here? Why don't you look after yourself? And that kind of a reactivity. Yeah, there'll be other things that say, how does it matter? You've come here. Let's see what you have to do. Okay, it's very interesting. Now, as we go into a process work group, what happens is a greater and greater degree of self-disclosure and getting into deeper and deeper states of vulnerability and speaking about myself as a human being and reaching out to other people as human beings. Yeah. Now, in these groups, I have heard stories of unspeakable violence, unspeakable hurt. Yeah. Like, you know, caste fights and things like that. Incredible stuff. Okay, I've actually heard stories related to me by this young person sitting in front of me of how, because he walked through a village road street with his chappals on, he was beaten up. Right? And when through my listening, I touch him at a human level and I understand and empathize and suffer with him, sahridayatva, na? Something happens and he sees me as a human being, right? And then the way they relate to you is completely, completely changed. I'm saying this possibility exists in India. And he can then take me away from symbolizing me as a Brahmin, see me as a human being, right? And the greatest gift I've got, Rajni, from working in these groups, yeah, is in one of these groups, there's a person called John. At the end of the group, on the last day, he says, I'm going to sing a song. You have to tell me the meaning. And he sings a Sanskrit song of the Nachiketa's dialogue with Yama. And he asks me to tell the meaning. Right? So whatever I knew, I shared with him. And then he says, I wish we people had not been deprived of this learning for all this time. Yeah? Now at that moment, I think he helped me and healed me in a more deep way than he healed himself. Right? Because it helped me in many many ways. It helped me look at my reality from a historical perspective. It helped me own up my Brahminhood without shame. And it also told me that if I own up my Brahminhood properly today, I can serve. And if I gave it up and became westernized because I hold it in shame, I'm doing myself and him a great disservice. It was a very beautiful moment, right? And these moments, I think, are the moments when one is dealing with very deep himsa of the Indian psyche, right? And this kind of decolonizing, na, is extremely important. And Ashish Nandi also talks about internalizing the oppressor and so on, right? These are the ways in which this can be overcome, right? And the other interesting thing, Rajni, is in these groups, na, what I've seen is people who are very close to each other and so-called caste hierarchies hold their divisions more acutely than other people.
Explain.
See, if a person is so-called lowest class and OBC or something, na, I wouldn't know the difference because I haven't really cared to understand these things in much depth. But when you're sitting in a group, from the way the person uses language, the nuances of what they say, they figure out whether this person is from this caste or whatever. Right? People who find it most difficult to give up these caste differences are people whose castes are so-called close to each other in hierarchy. Right? So to me, it's something like, you know, there's a deep shame of some kind that is held inside. And all these caste differences and so on have become proxies through which one claims a certain kind of position or certain kind of power or a certain kind of voice. But the fundamental issue that the Indian voice has been lost is not understood. And this Indian voice has been lost not just by the person who's the Dalit. It's been lost by the so-called educated Indian also. Because he holds his own Indian voice in great shame. And often in great fear. Fear of speaking up. That if I speak up from my Indian voice, I'm going to be held somehow as not good enough. Yeah, and this is what I've come across in business organizations very often.
Yeah. Say more about that, please.
See, when I go into business organizations and work there, huh, one of the things I found is there are two levels of ways in which people are working very, very clearly. Okay. One is the Sarkari way and one is their a more Indian way. It's not at all very different from the village story I told you. The consensus building process. See, the consensus building process, which in many ways is the old Indian process, right, is held in shame. And the official process is held in respect, or whatever, is held as official and correct, right? So let's say when I go to an organization and say, hey, look, can you have a consensus building forum through which you come up with people's performance? It releases so much of honesty, so much of clarity.
Can you please tell us about the Ritambara endeavor? And how I have a feeling that your endeavor in Ritambara is actually to address in some way or the other the totality of these concerns which you have highlighted. Also, firstly, to most of us, you will have to explain why the word Ritambara and what is the process that you and Shashi and other colleagues are working on. And in what ways that is your contribution to a non-violent India in the present and future?
I don't know about non-violent India, but non-violent few people, let's say. Yeah? Okay. I mean it, huh?
Yes.
In any case, see, the way Ritambara has come about is because there's another track which we haven't talked about, which I've been very deeply involved in, which is what I learned from Professor Pullen Garg, who also happens to have Gandhian roots, very interestingly. So he's one of the pioneers of what is called encounter group work or sensitivity work in India. Yeah, and his point of view in his own way of looking at his work was very deeply influenced by Gandhiji in the sense of he would often quote my experiments in truth, na, as a very critical way of working with oneself, right? And that book is full of self-disclosure, right? The way Pullen would explain it, it is like a an experimenting with the self, then discovering what is happening to you, deep, honest self-disclosure, and then trying to create a meaningful framework for yourself based on some study, various things, right? So we know that Gandhiji's study had a lot to do with Jain philosophy. It had a lot to do with studying the Bhagavad Gita and so on. So this pattern of working with the self is what Pullen would talk about. And this is the deep work that I was telling, which I have done with the Dalits and all that, na? Where you sit for a week at a time or something and really go through deep self-disclosure and trying to understand and reinterpret oneself, not from the same old hurtful ways of looking at oneself, but discover free ways. You know, in a sense, what here Dharampalji comes into the picture again, in ways that reclaim, first of all, your swatantrata of thinking, and therefore your swabhiman, which is very, very critical. That leads to understanding my swadharma and acting from my swadharma. Simultaneously, I was studying with Krishnamacharya for 10 years. I've been studying Yoga Sutra. Now, the idea of self in a Western context, which unfortunately is where most of this work is sourced, and the idea of self in the Indian texts are very, very different. I'll just give you one small example. Self-actualization is a big thing in the humanistic philosophy. Yeah, that takes an idea of an individualistic, atomized self as a reality. A lot of that philosophy has been influenced by study of Eastern stuff. Okay, people like Maslow have studied Eastern stuff. In the East, if I use a Yoga Sutra philosophy for self-actualization, it would actually be dissolving this idea of individuality. Yeah? So at one level, though they look the same, there are very deep differences. So I've been continuously experimenting with this whole thing of how do I bring in a Yoga Sutra-based orientation towards understanding of the self and understanding the mind. Right? So that is what Ritambara is all about. And Ritambara is a Yoga Sutra word. Ritambara means filled with the truth of life. Yeah, and the connection with Gandhian philosophy or whatever you want to call it, na, is because when I was 60, Sashi and I had just turned 60, and we were saying, okay, what is the Vanaprastha all about? Right? So very strangely, a small group of people, about 15, 20 people, came up and said, we've been activists, we've tried this, we've tried that. Can you help us to work with the activism through Yoga Sutra? Right? So I said, okay, are you people willing to be guinea pigs? And they said, yeah. Okay. I was serious about it because we had to experiment with this. So they call themselves the sacred activists now. And many of them are very anchored in Gandhian study. We actually do some work with Swaraj, Hind Swaraj, trying to understand Hind Swaraj. And what we work with is a mixture of Yoga Sutra, understanding the Yoga Sutra in a very experiential way, not in a theoretical way, right? Working with the Mahabharata to understand the self, because Mahabharata also got a very powerful way of looking at archetypal energies. And then applying it in specific areas. Yeah, like how do you create dialogue between people with diverse mindsets and so on. So what we're trying to do in Ritambara is just this, to create a set of, you know, people called sacred activists who have a strong anchorage in the Indian idea of psychology, Indian idea of self, Indian processes of dialogue, and then apply it for creating ahimsatmic ways of dealing with issues.
What would be your advice to a young person, say today, who wants to work with Ahimsa, but sometimes feels overwhelmed by what they see around them? What are some of the doable things, I mean, things that they could do in their own life that would help them on that path?
I think the first thing would be to help them, or to ask them, can they anchor themselves on being human first and everything else later? Because all the other identification possibilities are realities, right? I cannot get away from the fact of where I was born. I cannot get away from the fact of how I was educated and so on, right? But I don't have to identify with them and hang on to them as my defense mechanisms, right? So the moment I really anchor myself on saying I'm a human being first, I can listen to another person's pain without defending it, without explaining it away, and so on. And if I do that, honestly, I will come upon the right action. Yeah. It's only if I keep interpreting human suffering and things through frames that are, first of all, foreign to me, and secondly, without my understanding it, if they become defensive frameworks, then whatever I do is going to add to the Ahimsa. Right? So in India, we have to watch out for two levels of Ahimsa. Na? One is using frames that are not relevant to us. And second is some of our own indigenous frames can also become very defensive and therefore oppressive and aggressive. Huh? So yeah. One has to be conscious of it and see how to get away from these two. And being human is not all that difficult. You just have to be willing to be vulnerable.
Yeah. Thank you so much.